Okay. It's a great honor to have today with us Professor García, who has a really impressive CV. So I will be brief. Professor García has a degree in chemistry and a PhD in organic photochemistry. And he's a full professor in the University Politecnica of València since 1996. He has 832 articles in peer-reviewed journals and an age factor of 108. So his research includes catalysis by gold nanoparticles, catalysis by metal organic frameworks, plasmon photocatalysis by gold nanoparticles, and photocatalytic activity of metal organic framework, and many more. And of course, he is going to talk to us to present us his research now. Professor García, I would like really to thank you for accepting our invitation and look forward to hear you.
Thank you, Maria, for your introduction. I hope that the line, the quality of the line is good and you can hear me well.
But yes,
I noticed that I noticed that the quality is not perfect, but anyway, I'm going to try to do my best. I have to say that these virtual or remote conferences are never the same, because the personal contact and relations that you establish when you are traveling is always much better. So I hope that you can invite me to be there. But anyway, what I am going to do is to present our work on, I'm just sharing my screen. I hope that you can see now my screen. I'm going to change the pointer. Yes. So we were commenting before with Georgios about the interest on hydrogen. And actually I'm going to talk about hydrogen and photocatalytic CO2 reduction because they can be renewable fuels. And the point is how to obtain these renewable fuels using solar light. And just in this presentation, I will focus in one area of research that we have been working, that is the use of materials, metal organic frameworks, as photocatalysts for the production of these renewable fuels. So first, I will put a little bit the topic into context, talking about renewable energy, and then I will describe our results in overall water splitting. Overall means that we are not using any other chemical, just pure water, or photocatalytic CO2 reduction. And finally, I will reach some conclusions. Well, solar fuels, typically, you consider different materials, different chemicals that can be used in transportation, because the problem with solar light is that during the night, there is no light. So this is intermittent. And also the power density of solar light is very low. So we have to concentrate solar light as primary source into chemicals. And these chemicals, by the chemical bond, have enough energy and will be used in transportation. We can consider in this regard also biomass as a solar fuel, because really the footprint, the CO2 footprint of biomass is or can be low, ideally zero. But this is done with the use of light, naturally. And what I'm going to comment is another type of photosynthesis that we call artificial photosynthesis. And the target is the production of hydrogen from water by using solar light or CO2 reduction. We can do this. We can generate hydrogen with solar light with different materials, typically metal oxide semiconductors and also some organic compounds, molecules like porphyrins. But we are trying to develop highly efficient, extremely efficient and robust materials. And one type of these materials are metal organic frameworks. The important thing of these materials is that they are crystalline, so you can characterize very well because they have XRD diffraction and have a high porosity. This is a model of a metal organic framework in where you can see that the porosity, this material is almost empty. And actually, the framework density, meaning the mass that we have in a certain volume, is the lowest in any material. So basically, the material is totally empty. These metal-organic frameworks are constituted by metallic nodes, here in red, that they are held in a position using rigid organic linkers. Typically, these organic linkers are polycarboxylates, but also I will comment in our work with other linkers that they are not carboxylic acids. The important thing of this material is this one, because this material is hybrid, it contains an organic component and an inorganic component. With the organic component, we can introduce functionality. And actually, the important thing in photocatalysis is to have an organic linker that meets the role of harvesting solar light and doing photochemistry and exciting the metallic node. And I will comment about the mechanism of this operation, the photocatalytic system. So one example of this metal or frameworks, one of the first examples is this MOF5, in where what we have are nodes, these metallic nodes, they are constituted by four zinc 2 plus cations, and these four here in the trahedra in blue, they are connected in the center by an oxygen. So these four tetrahedra, they are sharing an oxygen, and then the organic linker is just connecting the nodes. In this case, the organic linker is tereftalate, a dicarboxylic aromatic compound, and then we have that a very large volume that is here just in yellow. One of the problems of the MOF is that they say that they are not stable. And this is certainly the case of MOF5. Just when you prepare MOF5 and you put in water, then the material changes. And some of the linkers are replaced by the action of water, are replaced by hydroxyl groups. However, this is not the case of every MOF. And in contrast to the behavior of MOF5, in the case of MIL101, this is a very strong and very robust MOF. For instance, you can heat this material at 400 degrees and nothing happens. The extractor of the material is maintained, and also chemically is a very robust material. So you can just put in a very aggressive, strongly acidic liquid like chlorosulfonic acid, and actually the material still remains and nothing changes. So this MIL101 is constituted by a metal node. In this case, we have three chromium 3 plus cations. These chromiums here are in green, is an octahedra, and these three chromium ions, they share one oxygen in the center. So here we have the nodes. And these nodes are connected again with tereftalic acid. And we have two types of cages in the material. One cage that is here in green that has a pentagonal openings, and the diameter of the opening is 1.3 nanometers. And here we have other type of cages in where the opening of this cage is hexagonal, and then the pore diameter of this is a little bit larger, about 1.5 nanometers. So these are the two type of cages. Again, this material is highly porous, and the surface area, the specific surface area of MIL101 can reach almost 2000 square meters per gram. So porosity, this material is very large. Just long time ago, we reported the first example of hydrogen generation photocatalytically using light with a MOF. In this case, was UIO66 amino. And this material, this MOF, is constituted by nodes, metallic nodes. Here we have six zirconium 4 plus ions. And because the charge of the zirconium is plus 4, while in the other cases we have a zinc plus 2 or chromium plus 3, the largest is the charge of the cation, the stronger is the lattice. And this material, UIO66, is very strong, very resistant, very robust MOF, and can stand, for instance, indefinitely in boiling water. So this is the node, and the linker is tereftalic acid, and this is the structure, the cubic extractor of UIO66, in where we have here the nodes, and we have the linker connecting the nodes. And what we did is that we introduced in the linker one amino group. So if you introduce in the linker one amino group, nothing changes. So the material is isostructural, and actually the XRD that you obtain in the material is exactly the same, no matter if the linker contains the amino group or not. So we have two materials that they have the same structure, but now there is a big difference from the photochemical point of view, is that this chromophoric group, the amino, introduces a new band in the optical spectrum. And this new band absorbs over 400 nanometer, so has a response in the visible. So we can excite with solar light, because the target in the area is to use natural sunlight to obtain hydrogen. So while in red, we have the absorption of the parent UHO66 that only absorbs up to 300 nanometers in the UV, the analogous material in where we have is an amino group now absorbs in the visible. And then we can generate hydrogen using, in this case, methanol as electron donor. So this was the first example long time ago. And we have been working in this area of using these materials for more efficient hydrogen production. And this is the reason why we have a lot of interest in metal organic frameworks. And the reason is tunability. We can optimize, we can modify the material in different ways to increase the efficiency for photocatalytic conversion. So we can modify the metal node. And I will show one example, one of the best examples, and we're changing the node, we increase the efficiency for hydrogen production. But also we can modify the organic linker. I have just commented the first example in where we put an amino group in the linker, this very simple example, but introduces visible light response in the material. But also we can use co-catalyst. We can use the empty space and introduce here something like a metal or metal oxide that favors the evolution of gases, favors the formation of hydrogen, and favors the formation of oxygen. They are called co-catalysts because the activity comes from the lattice, from the framework, but this improves the efficiency of the photochemical process. And also something that we have learned recently is that if we generate defects in the structure, for instance, here we have a missing linker, then the activity of the material increases just because in this case, what we have are under-coordinated metal centers. So they can coordinate better with water, and because they coordinate better with water, the activity increases. And this is the general photocatalytic mechanism that happens to occur in almost all examples. And the system has a linker. Here is the linker. And this in red and yellow is the metal node. So the linker is excited with light. And then upon excitation of the linker, because the linker is negative, we are talking of polycarboxylates. So this means negative anions. And because the cation is positive, we are talking of zirconium plus four or chromium plus three. So this is positive and this is negative. If we excite with light, then one electron goes from the electron rich part to the electron poor and we have charge separation. So the electrons go here to the nodes and the linkers become positive. And this charge separation is the key photocatalytic event that will generate hydrogen from water, because this hydrogen generation is a reduction and we need electrons to reduce water. So these electrons are coming from the linker and initially goes to the metal, and the metal will catalyze just the evolution of hydrogen. So we would like to understand better this mechanism and to increase the efficiency of this photocatalytic charge separation. What I'm going to do now in the following minutes is just to show how by doing this very simple approaches, we can increase the activity, the photocatalytic activity of the materials. And I want to stress what is now the current state of the art in the highest efficiency for hydrogen. So another example is this one we call multivariate because what we have is a UIO68 in this case. In this case, the typical organic linker is terphenyl dicarboxylate. So we have three aromatic rings here, and the terphenyl can be substituted by other linker. And this long linker has in the central ring a tetracene. And actually this is yellow and this is orange. because the material, when you form with tetracycline linkers, has a pink color. So the idea is that we can control the degree of exchange. We start with a material that contains only terphenyl, and what we are going to do is to modify in a controlled way progressively this linker and to introduce some tetracycline linkers. So this is what we do. We can do this simply by exposing the solid to a solution that contains a high concentration of this linker. And then because this bond is reversible, what you are going to do is to exchange this linker by a new linker. So these are the photographs of the materials that we can form. We start with this icosahedra, and as you increase the degree of exchange, we finalize in another sample that has color, and this color is the characteristic color of the linker. We did this because theoretical calculations predict that if we exchange the terphenyl by this tetracycline linker, what happens is that we introduce in the gap, so this is the conduction band, this is the Bayless band, and what we introduce in the middle are some states. This is similar to the doping concept in semiconductors. And by doing this, what we are doing is just narrowing the band gap. So this means that this material with tetracycline will absorb more light and longer wavelength. And actually we confirm these theoretical predictions that just a minor amount of this tetracycline linker is enough to narrow the band gap. So this is the theoretical calculations, and this is the experimental value. As you can see, the trend is predicted. However, the value of the band gap was not predicted, and the real material has a higher band gap than expected. One thing that is very interesting is because we start with a material that contains terphenyl. When we see the fluorescence microscopy, we see a crystal that fluoresces in blue. But when we increase the exchange by tetracycline, we see that the external surface of the crystals become to fluoresce in orange. And if we progress in the exchange of the linker, more orange. And finally, when the exchange is very large, all the crystal is orange or red. And this indicates that our procedure to replace one linker by other starts with the external surface, and then it goes deeper and deeper and penetrates into the crystal. So this is important. This is important because this is the concept. We start with one material in where we have two linkers, one in yellow, the other in pink. And what happens is that during a certain degree of exchange, what we have is the external surface is totally replaced by the pink linker, in this case tetracycline, while the internal surface, the internal part, has already contains tetracycline. So this in photochemistry is called a core shell or heterojunction. Heterojunction because we have a combination of two different materials with different photocatalytic properties, and the combination of these materials when the surface area of the contact is very large is very useful to promote charge separation. And actually this is what happens, because if we measure the hydrogen evolution, there is one material in where the hydrogen evolution is much better. So if we go to a deeper degree of exchange, then what happens is that the hydrogen evolution is getting worse. And this is normal because we know in photochemistry that there is always an optimal amount of the dopant. If you excess the amount of dopant, then what happens is that the photocatalytic efficiency decreases, and this is because charge recombination starts to appear. So here the optimal for hydrogen evolution is at this point. And please pay attention to this number. This is 100 micromoles of hydrogen per gram of catalyst, because this number is the one that we would like to have, about 10,000 micromoles or something like this. So our target is to go from this number 100 to 10,000. You may think that we are far, but I hope that during this presentation, I will show you that we are not that far. Another approach, as I have already commented, is to change the metal nodes. Actually, this was already predicted by Trular group, and where they make calculations again with this material, UiO56, in where they theoretically replace the zirconium atoms by other different metals. And they predict that depending on the metal, the band gap should change to change. And also what we thought is that because the band gap and electronic properties change, probably the hydrogen evolution will also change. And in fact, these calculations were confirmed experimentally with our work, because we prepared this material with zirconium, but also with a certain degree of exchange with titanium. And also we prepare a material with cerium, and then the combination of cerium and zirconium, and cerium, zirconium and titanium. Of course, the optical absorption of the materials changes depending on the composition. And this is a good signal, because it's telling us that the band gap of the material will be modulated by the presence of other metals. And importantly, when we make the photocatalytic hydrogen generation, we observe that the best material is the one that contains the three metals, zirconium, cerium, and titanium. And actually, we go to an efficiency about 0.15. So this means that 1,000 photons give 15 molecules of hydrogen. So the efficiency, just to have an idea of what is the efficiency that we are reaching now in photocatalysis, is about this: 1%, 2% of the photons make the photocatalytic reaction. We generate hydrogen. But pay attention to this, we also generate oxygen, because in this experiment we are using only pure water. So this is really overall water splitting, in where we generate hydrogen, that is the wanted chemical, the fuel, the solar fuel, but we also generate oxygen that can be useful for oxidations and other purposes. The material is stable. I have already said that UiO66 is a very stable and robust material, and you can reuse, and the temporal profile of the hydrogen generation is coincident, meaning that the material has not changed, and also XRD pattern coincides, so that the material has not changed during the photochemical reaction. A third approach is just to introduce co-catalyst inside the material. In this case, the MOF that we are using is MIL-125 amino. This MOF contains titanium, and actually the nodes are constituted by 8 titanium atoms, forming like a cluster of titanium dioxide in a certain way. And these titanium dioxide clusters, they are connected by the linker. In this linker is tereftalate. And here in this MOF, MIL-125, we have two cavities, one cavity that is about one half that is here is in green, and another cavity that is the double that is in yellow. So in this cavity is about a dimension about 3 nanometers. We want to introduce in this cavity of 3 nanometers the co-catalyst. And we use as co-catalyst cobalt oxide, platinum, ruthenium oxide, and the combination of platinum and ruthenium. The particle size, as you can see, is very small. We have particles between 1 and 2 nanometers. We have particles between 2 and 3 nanometers. And we have just a small fraction larger than this, that we suppose that these larger particles, they are on the external surface. While these two large population of particles are incorporated inside the cavities of the material. In the case of the platinum, again, the particle size distribution indicates that most of the platinum has very small particle size, between 1 and 2 nanometers. So this small particle size indicates, or is compatible with, the fact that the particles are inside the cavities. And with these materials, we perform overall water splitting, photocatalytic overall water splitting, and here we have the hydrogen evolution in black, and we have the oxygen evolution just in the open cycles. And here we have 150 micromoles of hydrogen per gram of catalyst. So now we have 100 micromoles, we are progressing. In the case of the platinum, the evolution of oxygen is less, and this we know because the controlling step is the oxygen evolution. So we need a catalyst that favors oxygen, not hydrogen. And for this reason, the influence of the cobalt is larger. In the case of ruthenium oxide, we also have oxygen and hydrogen evolution. And this plot presents, this is the overall water splitting, the production on overall water splitting that you can see that is very low. And this compares with the evolution of hydrogen if we add a sacrificial electron donor. If we add methanol in this case, so then we can go to 2 millimoles, so not micromoles. Note that in this case, the scale is micromoles, but in this case, the scale is millimoles. So if we add sacrificial electron donor like methanol, we know that then the production of hydrogen is much higher. But the purpose of this research is to obtain hydrogen from pure water. So then the optimal material with co-catalyst goes to 250 micromoles of hydrogen. We also generate the half amount of oxygen, putting platinum and ruthenium as co-catalyst. So all the strategies that I have shown up to now show that we can increase the efficiency of hydrogen evolution just by modifying the MOF. Another approach is the generation of defects. And in this case, what we did is to treat the material MIO-125 with plasma, and with plasma, what we generate are defects in the structure. These defects, the extension and the level of the defects is not so high. And for this reason, XRD does not reveal any change. So the XRD of the materials exposed to the plasma treatment are coincident. However, when you measure XPS, you see changes. Particularly important is the oxygen 1S. What we see in oxygen XPS is the evolution of a new peak that corresponds to titanium hydroxyls and titanium hydroperoxyls. And these new peaks indicates that there is an additional oxygen. So this peak corresponds to carboxylate is decreasing while this is increasing. So our interpretation of this is that under plasma, we are generating defects, and these defects correspond to the decarboxylation of amino tereftalic acid. So here we have a decarboxylated position, and these positions that were initially occupied by the carboxylate, now what we have are hydroxyl groups, these defects. We can also see the generation of defects in the other parts of the XPS. For instance, in the carbon, we see that the carboxylate peak disappears, decreasing intensity, because this disappears. And also we have determined by gas chromatography the evolution of CO2 during the process. So we have treated the material and we have generated defects. And then what happens is that the photocatalytic activity for overall water splitting increases when we expose the material MIL-125 to plasma treatment. So after 10 minutes of plasma treatment, we have the optimal generation of defects. And if we go further and we expose the material to larger time, so then the efficiency decreases even lower than the parent material. So again, there is an optimal amount of defects, and if you overcome this optimal amount of defect, then the activity decreases. Here we have plot A and plot B. This is really using a simulated sunlight, while this is just the sunlight, the light from a lamp. Light from a lamp, xenon lamp, and this is the light, simulated sunlight. Again, the optimal material is the one that has been treated with plasma for 10 minutes. And this is depending on the radiation wavelength. And what is important is here that using visible light, that is the target, using visible light, we have overall water splitting with generation of hydrogen and oxygen. Using simulated sunlight, what we have is about 80-90 micromole of hydrogen per gram of catalyst. The material, this material, MIL-125, is very stable. We already knew that. And what we observe is that photocatalytically, the temporal profile of evolution does not change when we reuse the material. Moving further, besides carboxylate, we have been exploring other type of ligands, and I will comment on two different type of ligands. One of these ligands is phosphonate, and because metal phosphonates are stronger bonds than metal carboxylates, so phosphonates really are more stable MOFs. This phosphonate with nickel is very interesting because we have an example of 2D MOF. So these 2D MOFs, they are materials in where we have is a very large lateral surface, but the thickness of this material is very small. Actually, the thickness of this material is about 2 or 3 nanometers. In the lattice, every time that we have the linker, there is a decrease of 0.35 nanometers. So in total, what we have in the material is about 10 layers of this single layer that will be the phosphonate. What we have here is a node. The node contains two nickels sharing two oxygens, and these two nickels that they are the nodes are coordinated with six ligands, and these ligands are the phosphonate. Interesting thing is that here, the difference in energy between the valence and conduction band is 2.83 nanometers. The ideal band gap in one material for overall water splitting should be 2. So this is a relatively narrow band gap MOF, but we have to progress towards a material that has a band gap of only 2 electron volts. Only 2 electron volts, but with a position in where still the conduction band can reduce protons to hydrogen, and the valence band can still oxidize water to oxygen. So we call this alignment. The alignment of the valence and conduction band have to be appropriate for producing the reduction of protons and oxidation of water. So this material is robust and is stable because it's a phosphonate and we can reduce several times and nothing changes. Here is plotted the efficiency of the material with UV and the efficiency of the material with visible light. Of course, we also observe oxygen, and here in this initial plot is a little bit confusing, the initial plot, because we have hydrogen and we have oxygen under UV visible. And then we have hydrogen and we have oxygen just only under visible light irradiation. But if we plot only hydrogen, then we have these other profiles that are coincident with the one that is obtained for the fresh material. Also, not only the temporal profile is coincident, but also the XRD of the material has not changed. And my last example is one that is just the record. Well, it's not the record, but it's the record that I can tell you now. It's the record for overall water splitting in the case of the MOFs. This material is again contains a titanium, and actually it's very interesting the structure because it's like 2D titanium dioxide. We have here in the node 18 titanium atoms, six forming this octahedra, other six in the external octahedra, and other six in trigonal bipyramids. So we have in total in this node 18 titania, and these nodes are coordinated forming a layer, and in between the layers we have the organic linker. The organic linker that we have is ascorbic acid, is this, that is a very simple molecule. It's very simple, but it's interesting because it has color. The color of this ascorbic acid, the ascorate, is orange. So we have here the light harvester. The light harvester is going to be in between the layers of titanium oxide, and then this will be excited and will be the electron transfer from the linker to the titanium layer. And this ascorbic acid is very interesting because it's very simple and also it's very stable. It's very stable, even though there is a square molecule, but it meets the Hückel rule because it contains only 2 electrons in non-cyclic compounds. So this is an aromatic example. Very interesting also is the band alignment. Band alignment, now the band gap of this material is 2.47. So still we would like to decrease this band gap, and we know how. Our target is to obtain a MOF with a band gap of 2 electron volts and is well aligned with the hydrogen reduction and oxygen evolution. So this is the band gap. With this material, we can generate hydrogen and oxygen from water just by irradiation, and we can use xenon lamp, and this is just the emission spectrum of a xenon lamp. This is very interesting because the xenon lamp emits here in the UV and in the visible a constant power for all wavelengths. So this is a constant power for all wavelengths going from the UV to the visible range. This is the infrared. In contrast to this, we have also the productivity with sunlight. And the sunlight spectrum is different because we can see that we have just a maximum in the visible, about 500 nanometers. 500 nanometers, we have nothing in the UV, and then the intensity decreases as the wavelength increases. So this is the part that we would like to use of solar light for the photocatalytic reaction as the natural photosynthesis that they use this region of the solar light. And this compares with this. For this reason, there is a difference always. When you excite with a lamp, we have higher efficiency. With solar light, the efficiency is lower because we have this, we don't have a wavelength in the UV. But note to this, the efficiency here is 600 micromoles per gram. 600, if you remember, what we are looking for is about 10,000 micromoles per gram of catalyst, 10,000, but we have started this presentation about 80, and now the 80 about here, efficiency in this range, and now we have going to 200, now we have going up, and now we are going even up. So how far are we from reaching the target? My impression is that we are not that far. This material is stable. This is not surprising because we have titanium, a titanium MOF that they are always very stable, and also the linker is stable. This is the profile of hydrogen generation, and this is the profile of oxygen generation. Note that in this case, the material has been exposed to solar light for more than 1 week, and the activity is constant. Also, after extensive reuse, XRD does not change. And the last part of my presentation is about photocatalytic CO2 reduction. We are going to comment two different reactions. One reaction is artificial photosynthesis, in where CO2 is reduced by water. This reaction is extremely difficult because thermodynamically is very endorgonic. This reaction is very difficult, and for this reason, the efficiency is low. Also, kinetically, is very challenging because the barriers that we have to overcome in the mechanism, they are very high. So for this reason, the efficiency of artificial photosynthesis is much higher, is much lower than overall water splitting. In contrast to this, I am going to present also some details on CO2 methanation, photocatalytic CO2 methanation, that this reaction is much easier because actually this reaction is exothermic. So we can do photocatalytic CO2 reduction using this molecule, this a molecular photocatalyst, in where we have a light harvesting here in blue. The light harvesting is ruthenium, and we have a catalytic part that is rhenium. So if you excite the dye, the ruthenium polypyridyl, if we excite this, this dye is orange, so then one electron goes from this part to the rhenium. And then the rhenium contains two carbonyl groups that can be exchanged by CO2. If we exchange one CO by CO2, then we have one electron, we can reduce CO2 to carbon monoxide. And then the carbon monoxide is replaced again by another CO2. So this is the molecular ruthenium-rhenium complex that is known to be able to do a photocatalytic CO2 reduction. And our target was to try to mimic this complex, molecular complex, in a MOF. And we can do this very simple because there is one MOF that is 253 aluminum, in where the linker is 2-2' bipyridyl. And this 2-2' bipyridyl is actually the ligand of this ruthenium and this rhenium. So initially, we prepare in this MOF the rhenium catalytic part, and then we irradiate by using a ruthenium polypyridyl that now is not going to be connected. So in this experiment, we are using this MOF with the rhenium in a satellite position of the MOF lattice, and we are going to excite with ruthenium tris bipyridyl. We observe that we don't generate hydrogen. This is good because the target is just the reduction of CO2 without the production of hydrogen, but we form CO and formic acid. The important thing is here that the catalytic activity of the material does not stop and goes on even after 4 hours irradiation. If we compare this with the molecular complex, here we have the comparison. This is the performance of the molecular complex, of this complex. What we observe is that after 4 hours, the activity disappears. And this is well known, is because the complex decomposes. The composite basically becomes oxidized and dimerizes. So then the activity disappears by decomposition. But in the case of the MOF, because this rhenium is attached and immobilized in the lattice, it cannot dimerize so easily. And for this reason, the activity and stability is much higher. And we can more than double the efficiency of the molecular complex. But we can go one step further by putting the two parts in the MOF. So now we have the light harvesting, that is the rhenium in orange because the color of this part is orange. And we have here the rhenium part because the color of the rhenium complex is yellow. So, and then the target is to excite the ruthenium that is also anchored in the MOF. And then the ruthenium will pass electrons and will go the electrons to the rhenium that will be the catalytic part, and then CO and formic acid will be formed. And actually what we observe is that the efficiency of the MOF with the two components, the ruthenium and the rhenium, is much higher, more than double the efficiency of the MOF just having the single component, the catalyst. You should not forget that this performance of the MOF was the double than the molecular complex. So in this case, we have already the double than the molecular complex. In this case, we are multiplying the efficiency of the molecular complex by a factor about 6. So this is CO2 reduction, but please pay attention to this, that in this case, we are using an electron donor, a sacrificial agent to generate protons and electrons. This is not the case of the previous part of my talk, in where I was using, in most of the cases, just pure water. So, and this is because, as I have already said, photocatalytic CO2 reduction, in this case, these reactions, they are very endothermic and thermodynamically also very demanding. For this reason, we need to put some sacrificial electron donors. The target in this area will be just to perform the reaction in the absence of these components. And just the last example is this one, in where we have again another titanium MOF. Titanium MOF, in this case, the titanium is forming a 1D chains. 1D chains, the chains are like helicoidal chains. And these chains are helicoidal because the linker here is isophthalic with an angle, and the angle of isophthalic determines that the titanium has to become like this. The important thing with this isophthalic is that we can introduce here in this position another substituent like fluorine or trifluoromethyl groups. And in this case, the polarity of the internal pores, the polarity of the channels can be modified by the presence of this linker, and we can obtain highly hydrophobic materials. And with this titanium MOF, we can perform the methanation of CO2 with hydrogen to methane and water. This reaction can be done also catalytically, but typically the reaction with catalysis like iron or cobalt is carried out at 500 degrees. Here, by using light, we also need some temperature. The temperature here is 200 degrees. And I will comment later why we need temperature. But this is much lower than the catalytic process. So in other words, if we don't put light, we don't have any methanation. The methanation without light is zero. But if we use light, either UV visible light, that is here in blue, Or if we use simulated sunlight that is in orange, so then we start to form methane. And then again, we always study the stability of the photocatalyst. Stability is very good, and we know this because the comparison of the temporal profile is reproducible. So we have said that we need temperature for this reaction, and we also know the mechanism of this methanation. Our understanding now is that we need temperature because the reaction forms water, and this water becomes absorbed in the material and then acts as a poison. So as soon as water is formed, this active site becomes blocked because water is strongly absorbed. But if we heat, then water becomes desorbed, and we have a chance that the two gases, CO2 and methane, also can become absorbed in this site. So for instance, here is the influence of the temperature. If we perform the reaction at 100 degrees, nothing happens. But if we increase the temperature 150, some reaction starts to occur, and then the efficiency goes to 200 degrees. That is the highest efficiency. We know and we have proved that water is influencing the efficiency because we make an experiment using 200 degrees and we add water on purpose at the beginning. And if we add water in a certain amount, then the activity, instead of being this, like in the blue line, goes down to the green line. Why? Because water is a poison and we are now just performing the reaction, adding at the beginning water. So then water is strongly absorbed and this decreases the initial rate and the final conversion. So for this reason, we need temperature, but we know we have additional information, and is that this temperature that we measure is not the real temperature at the site in where the reaction occurs. The reaction occurs in the nodes with nanometric dimensions. And what is the role of light? The role of light is to heat. Actually, what we are converting is the energy of the light into heat. And we know this by these simple molecular thermometers. So we have here the emission of the thermometer. This is when the thermometer, the thermocouple, is telling us that the material is at 50 degrees. In reality, in the place where the reaction occurs, should be much higher. Why? Because this thermometer has lower emission. Lower emission meaning that the temperature there is not 50, but it's much higher. And if we perform the same experiment at 150 degrees, this is the performance of the thermometer at 100 degrees in the dark. But if we illuminate, then the temperature becomes higher and it's not 150, it should be higher than this, and then the thermometer does not emit. So in this case, the mechanism is very interesting because what we are using is photons to heat just at the molecular scale. And this is just the end of my presentation. So the take home messages of this presentation is that now is the time we were commenting at the beginning of this seminar with Giorgio that there is a lot of interest for hydrogen production. So now is time for this research, because if we are able to develop a system that converts sunlight into hydrogen or is able to reduce CO2, then this will be a very important step forward. So now is the moment. And in the case of the metal organic frameworks, I have shown you that we can increase the activity by playing with different things. One thing is the organic ligand, that we have to select a very robust and stable organic ligand, but also organic ligands that absorbs in the visible light. We have also to select the metals, and we know that D0 and D10 metals are the optimal for these photocatalytic reactions. We can also tune the material and increase activity by modulating the density of defects. And we can do this, for instance, by using plasma or thermally or using chemical agents. And also the incorporation of co-catalyst is very important because in that way we increase the activity. And there is a target to become commercial. Our target is just to use only 5% of the solar light to convert this into hydrogen. Natural photosynthesis is working now at an efficiency that is about 6%. But natural photosynthesis is preparing, is forming glucose and very complex biomolecules. And our target here is just to form very simple molecules like methane or hydrogen. So only 5% will be enough or have something that is useful. The only problem is that durability of the material has to be about 1 year, and the material has to be cheap and affordable. And the last message is that photocatalytic CO2 reduction is much more difficult. And for this reason, the efficiency in photocatalytic CO2 reduction is much lower, and the technology readiness level is lower. And with this, I am done. I want to thank people of my group that has participated in this research. And also I want to thank people that have funded this research and you for inviting me to be there, although virtually, but I am there. And now, thank you for everything.
Thank you, Professor Garcia, for your very nice talk. Do we have any questions from the audience?
Can you